As you walk through the valley of the shadow of hell, you will realize that there is something ahead. Something that lurks behind the dark veil. A veil that is beyond our own comprehension. Beyond the veil.
Welcome to Beyond the Veil
Horror Podcast.
That is correct. Yes.
That was the second time we did it right.
It is fantastic.
We're back and we're going to be doing a lot of stuff today. We got the contest, one of the contestants.
Oh, dude, for sure, man.
Yeah, we picked, we're going to be doing a holiday horror theme show for you today. And for this week. And so we're picking the holiday, one of the people that picked a holiday horror shot. Then next week, we'll be doing the Santa.
Yeah.
So you still have time, by the way, guys. If you're interested in winning a free Blu-ray, DVD, and CD, all you get to do is come up with a name of a shot themed around Santa Claus. Tell us the ingredients. Tell us the name. If you want to add a tagline, however you want to do it.
Yeah.
Just let us know that. But other than that, it's just holiday horror for this episode.
Right.
Anything that's not Santa Claus. So there were slim pickings on this one, I would say, right?
Yeah, it's not bad, though.
No, it's not bad, but there was a shit ton of fucking Christmas horror movies out there with Santa.
Right.
And it was hard just to find one without Santa.
Well, it's natural to want to go towards that.
Right.
I mean, think about it. It's like this beloved character. Why would you not want to shit all over it?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, that's the scariest part. It's like, oh, why would this beloved thing, like, be attacking me? In some form, whether they dress up as it or not, you know. I figure if they dressed up as it, it was a no-go for this episode.
Okay.
So, but how are you guys been doing?
I'm doing pretty all right.
Yeah. I don't know.
Same shit, different day.
Oh, well, that's encouraging.
Yeah. You know, just keep it minimum, guys. As long as you're happy, that's all you need in life.
Pretty much, dude.
How'd your Christmas pudding go?
Christmas pudding was fucking amazing, dude. The only band that I was kind of like on the edge about was the Hollywood Vampires, but they pulled it out. It was pretty good.
Really?
Yeah.
They pulled it out?
Johnny Depp band.
Yeah, I think it's Alice Cooper's band. Johnny Depp's just in it.
Huh.
But it was like... Everybody was focusing on Johnny Depp.
Well, I
didn't care about anybody else.
Obviously, dude.
Yeah, he's like a huge star.
Right. But, you know.
I mean, if I had a lineup of dick, I mean, never mind. Let's just skip over that.
What did he play bass? What's he play?
He plays rhythm guitar.
Rhythm guitar.
Oh, ain't bad. You know, rhythm guitar.
It was just kind of like, I don't know how to play guitar.
Right.
I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. Honestly, I'm more of a rhythm guitarist, too, if I play. But
right.
What about you, Mike?
Jack and shit and Jack left town, pretty much.
And Jack left hand?
Jack's left hand. I haven't really been up to much. I mean, watching some movies. Movies for this episode.
Yeah, you've been pounding them.
Yeah, movies unrelated to this episode, too.
Right.
Watching a lot of Ghost Adventures and Ghost Hunters.
Nice.
You know, which is really cool. Which I still want to... We'll have to talk about it later, but I really, 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 really want to do a paranormal episode still.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, we'll get that done for sure.
Oh, it's going to be fantastic.
I still think those episodes are just... Or those shows are more stick than carrot.
There was this one episode of... Well, let me say this. Okay. I've been watching a lot of Ghost Hunters lately.
Okay.
I haven't really watched... I mean, I haven't watched it for years, but I started catching up on it. And there was one episode from back in the day, I don't know how many seasons ago.
Ghost Hunters, you're saying?
Ghost Hunters, the original one. And, man, they had something that was like really hardcore, like blew my mind. Like, if it's legit.
Right.
I believe that it is, but it's so incredibly awesome.
You have to show me which one that is.
Yeah, it's basically like this. Jane Grant, I forget what I don't know if it was, I don't remember where they were, don't quote me. But anyways, they're basically in this room together, right? On this bed. They're fucking.
No, good story. I was like, where is this going? Anyway. No,
but, Grant basically says, like, I'm gonna get up and
I'm gonna get up.
Just the mental image that you made me, like, and then when you put a name to it, it just like struck. I like struck like disgusting gold with the pickaxe of destiny.
Grant gets up and he's like, look, I'm not feeling anything in this room. I'm gonna go to this other room across the hall, whatever. So he goes in the other room, right? And he's chilling in the room and he starts hearing whispering in his ear.
It's Grant.
Yeah, well, it's Grant in the room.
Oh, who was the other guy?
Jay.
Jay.
He's Jason, so Jason Haas.
So he comes in, he's like, hey, baby.
you wanna fuck, dude?
Ah, sorry.
No. Anyways, so Jason's in his own room, and Grant's in the other room. And Grant hears this whispering in his ear.
Okay.
And he's like, it doesn't make any fucking sense, because the entity that he hears says Atlantis in his ear.
Hmm.
And he's like, well, what the fuck? Is this ghost looking for the lost city of Atlantis? This makes no fucking sense. It's so dumb.
Right.
But he's like, I swear to God, I heard this thing say Atlantis in my ear. And he goes back into the room with Jay, and he's like, hey, Jay, so I heard this thing whisper in my ear, and it said Atlantis. And Jay's like, fuck, that's crazy, dude. Just go back and like see if anything else happens. So he goes back in this room again by himself. And Jay's like, and this is like to the camera and for the show. He's like, I fucking told this ghost to tell Grant a special word, and that word I told him to tell him was Atlantis.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and then he's like, I'm going to try this new word.
Did he say it on camera on the other side?
The second word he did. He's like, my new word that I'm going to tell him is comet. So he's like, okay, I'm going to say this word comet, C-O-M-E-T, comet. And then Grant's like in the other room, and then Grant comes back in a few minutes later. He's like, dude, I heard this other word. It's like comedy. Cometh or something.
Wow.
So it's
Comet
fucking
cometh, man.
It's so weird, man. Yeah. Yeah. So it's weird to me, man, because like if he literally told an entity to tell his buddy a word,
right?
That's legit shit, man.
Right. Well, I mean, it is, but then you start to wonder, like, if you're not there.
Yeah, like maybe they talked about it beforehand.
Yeah,
or some
exactly.
Shit.
Right. I know. Or well, it could very well be. But the thing is, this is the thing about these guys. I trust Jay and Grant.
Right. No. I'm not trying to, but I'm just saying, like, in the skeptic side of me is like thinking that.
Oh yeah.
Oh sure. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Was that like towards the end of their career?
I think it was towards the end of
Ghost Hunters, I mean.
Well, no, Ghost Hunters is still around, but I think that was around the time where Grant was leaving the
Wait,
show.
Ghost Hunters is still around?
They're around, they just don't have a TV show, I bet.
Oh, well, that's what I'm saying. The end
I
of the show.
They were still around. The show was still around.
I know they still show older episodes
to older crowds. They just show it in the old folks' home. It's like their special.
You guys
going
to be here soon.
Here's your special program.
Better get ready. anyways, yeah, not to diverge the show, but yeah, that's what I've been up to.
What I've been up to, I watched a few movies, like randomly, like ones that are not horror, by the way, because I was just like, you know what? I'm just going to, I don't know why, I was going to, getting ready to watch Lights Out, because I bought that and I haven't watched it again.
I've not seen it yet either.
I saw it at the theater, but I didn't watch it. So I was like, as I was watching the trailers, I saw this fucking Ben Affleck movie that was out, apparently, that I didn't even know about. It was called The Accountant.
Oh, I heard that's pretty good.
And it wasn't too bad. It's not amazing. It's not like Wolf of Wall Creek. Wall Street. I'm thinking of Wolf Creek.
Wolf of Wolf Creek. Yeah.
Anyway, the Wolf of Wall, it's not like that or anything. And it's not, it's much more action, but he plays like an autistic kid and he grows up.
Affleck does?
And yeah. And he learns, like, the kid learns how to fight because his dad's in the military and all this other shit. But it actually turned out to be okay. It wasn't amazing. And the dude from The Walking Dead, the deputy.
Oh, the guy, Shane.
Yeah, Shane, whatever. I know, I can't think of it either right now, because I wasn't prepared to talk about this. Also, I watched, fuck, what else did I watch? Oh, I watched Edward Snowden, and I also.
I've not seen it. Was it
any
good?
How was Snowden?
That was okay. I mean, it really humanizes him in a lot of way, and not that he isn't human or anything, but I'm just saying.
He might be a robot.
It kind of goes for that element more than anything. You know, like how much of a hero he is and everything, and how much balls it really did take to do what he did. Whether people think he's a fucking terrorist or not, regardless. But it's kind of about that. It's no Social Network or any of those, you know what I mean? And then I also watched a horror movie that I wasn't supposed to watch, you know, in our theme. And I watched The Pet.
I really wanted to watch that. You said it was okay. The Pet?
It's okay.
What's it about? I don't know it.
Essentially what happens is this guy, he lives a very lonely life. He works as a dog security guard. So yeah, he works at a pet's, at like a no veterinarian.
Well, dogs, no, he a dog security guard?
Yeah, he watches the veterinarian place at night.
Right.
So people don't break in and steal their shit.
Or steal their
and
dogs.
And it's like a pound, sort of. Like they put dogs to sleep. They try to get these things out. But he works with this other guy. And he runs into this girl on the bus that is somebody he went to high school with. And she turns out to be like this, like, she used to be really, like, popular in school. And he had, like, this big crush on her, and she was a grade below him or something. And he falls in love with her, and it starts to seem like, in the trailer, they kind of play it like he's a stalker. And then he eventually gets to the point where he locks her up in the basement of this veterinary place. Hmm. Because he has, you know, the whole place to himself for half the day.
Yeah.
So he hides her in this thing, and it starts to play like whether or not she's okay with it or not. And I don't want to spoil anything, but it has like two major twists in it. So it like twists and then it twists back. You're like, oh, fuck. Damn. Hmm. It was okay. I mean, I don't know. Maybe a 7.
I'll take it. I was kind of excited about the movie, but now you're kind of like deflating me a little bit.
I am, man. You know what? You can't tell from a trailer. You can make a guesstimation, but it's never going to be the same.
Hmm.
And if you want to see something really disgusting, you can watch Michael eat an ice cream cone while watching Two Girls, One Cup. That is in the information below. But anyway, other than that, I've just been busting my ass getting ready for the holidays. For the fam. But I think it might be that time, guys.
Oh my God.
Horrorshot! Okay, so as we mentioned before, we had a contest.
Yes.
For two contests, technically.
Oh.
To win a Blu-ray, DVD, and a
yes,
CD of our music.
Yes, good contest.
One of the, we were going to do one that was the holiday shot, and one was the Santa. We decided to do the holiday one, as we mentioned before, but I'm just reiterating it so that you know. But what we're going to be doing is we're going to be doing one of the shots that some of the people that signed up for the contest. Now, we had quite a few for the holiday one, believe it or not, and I thought it was going to be more Santa than holiday. What we did is we had a bunch of contestants that they wanted to enter. They made up a name, they came up with the ingredients, and they told us maybe a tagline or something if they wanted to. It wasn't necessary, but we had someone by the name of Traps McKnuckles, aka Frank, who happens to be a friend of my girlfriend's, who is a big fan of the show.
Nice.
And he did a video for us, which we posted here recently, doing the gut Krampus, or the Krampus, if you want to say.
What was his tagline?
Guten Krampus Natten, which means good Krampus night, which is the 4th. And he actually sent it to us on the 4th of December.
Oh.
So technically it was Krampus night.
Hmm.
Krampus Natten.
Mm.
But so when we take this shot, we got to say Guten Krampus Natten. Can you do that?
Oh,
can you do
that? I can do whatever you want me to do.
I want you to bend over and spread your legs. The ingredients for this shot are apple orchard, crisp apple hard cider.
That's hard. I like it.
You fill in the cup here. We'll put in a shot of Fireball and one shot of 99 peppermints, which is technically 99 bananas, but they do like a lot of different flavors.
It makes me bananas.
And then we're going to put in the final ingredient, which is you drop the shot in a shot glass at the final thing.
Yeah, kind of like a car bomb.
Yes, kind of like a car. Otherwise, it's a Boilermaker up until that point.
Well, it's a Boilermaker car bomb. Yes. It's like a combo. Yeah.
But we really, I know, we understand that this was a little bit, not just a shot, supposedly, but he put so much effort into it. He actually named the shot, made the shot, took the shot, and gave it a tagline and sent us a video for it because he was so excited about it. So congratulations to Traps McKnuckles, a.k.a. Frank.
Yes.
I gotta say too, I really appreciate the fact that he used a wild turkey in the shot.
Right?
One of my favorite fucking bourbons.
And I love, he's like, let's be adults about this, yeah. You know, and use wild turkey.
Dude, WT101's freaking fucking good, man.
So you pour the apple orchard first. Into the glass.
Do we pull the full beer?
Yeah. Then you put your fireball in. Then your 99 peppermint.
So I dump this whole fireball. Yeah,
just you dump it in like a Boilermaker. So it's just mixed in by itself.
Wow, this already smells weird.
Oh. Yes, Pat is looking forward to this one now.
Oh, no, dude, not full shot. Ah, crap. All right. Dude, you like did it so full, it's like spilling out all over me.
No. What are you doing? You're not supposed to do that.
I dropped it into the beer.
Okay, well, Mike and I are going to do it the right way.
Hold on.
So then you hold this shot, you pour a single shot of wild turkey, and you hold it to drop it in like you would a car bomb.
Yeah.
And then we drop it in, and then we say... Once we finish, we say Guten Krampus Natten. All right, here we go. Mike, you ready?
Yeah, I gotta get this.
You might want to get it closer so it doesn't spill on the mic.
Oh, I want to get audio of it.
All right, you ready?
Yeah.
All right, go.
Oh, ho, ho, ho.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
You didn't slam it? None of you guys slammed it? Well, Traps, I just want to let you know I did it the way it was supposed to be done here, buddy.
Guten Krampus.
Guten Krampus Natten.
Natten.
Guten Krampus Natten.
This wasn't too bad, actually. If you guys would have slammed it, it would have been a much easier going down.
I'm actually already, like, on that point of being too... Like, I'm not a big drinker, just to let you know out there. Mm-hmm.
He's a big thinker.
I'm a joker. I'm a smoker. I'm a midnight toker.
And a tampon wearer.
And yes. Only on those heavy flow days. You know, sometimes...
I don't know what that means. I don't know what that means.
You don't know what it means.
Anyway. Dude. Ooh.
It wasn't bad, though.
It really isn't.
No, it was bad.
It definitely... I like the ingredients for what he said, because that totally makes me think of, like, Krampus. You know what I mean?
Yeah, the peppermint schnapps. Or the peppermint, whatever in there.
99 peppermint, yeah.
Yeah, that really came through.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and the fireball, too.
A little bit, yeah.
I could taste it. Oh, man. Fuck, I don't know where I'm going to be after this.
You guys should have got a fucking funnel and poured it in my asshole. I mean,
if you think about it, we just took like 4 shots.
Not me. I didn't drink my whole shot. I'm sorry, guys.
Ah, what a puss.
It's sitting right next to me. I'm going to baby it.
Thank you so much, Traps. Frank, seriously, we salute you. Thank you for serving, my friend.
Fantastic, and, dude, for
seriously,
sure.
Seriously, thank you so much for going the extra mile and posting a video. We didn't ask that, and you totally did it on your own. And in the spirit of just having fucking fun, dude, thank you.
Yeah, dude, and that's why you hooked it up and won.
Yeah, dude. So we'll send you it out. I'll hit you up to see. We got like 3 Blu-rays and like 5 DVDs. And like 2 different CDs and stuff, or 4 different CDs technically. So we'll let you pick one.
We might
of those
even
out.
Send you a little DNA, depending on how this night turns out.
Pat's gonna squirt some out in a napkin for you and send it off.
Yep.
Use Jimmy.
But yeah, thank you guys again. You still have literally about 3 days. So the day that this comes out on the 12th, you will have till the 15th, midday Pacific Standard Time. To come up with another Santa shot, and we'll get you out a Blu-ray, a DVD, and a CD, and we'll let you even pick from the whatever's remaining after Frank gets his. So don't forget to write in the comments of Horror Amino, YouTube, Twitter, SoundCloud, anywhere that you can, let
Facebook,
us know.
Facebook, if anybody uses Facebook anymore.
Ain't nothing wrong with sloppy
just
seconds.
Just make sure you do it, because I wasn't very clear about this the last 2 times, but make sure you do it on our profile. Because if you don't, you know, sometimes it doesn't tag us on Facebook and shit.
Right.
So just make sure you go to our page and do it there. That's it for Horror Shots, guys.
Fantastic. There's something I really want to bring up that's very important. Do you know what that is?
I have no clue.
It's the news, you fucker! Here is the fucking news. We'll be right back.
one of the first things I want to bring up, which is a personal thing for me in regards to the news.
Okay.
Nick Groff's new show, season two, is starting pretty quick here, called Paranormal Lockdown.
Yeah, that's right. Well, and if you guys aren't familiar, Nick Groff is from Ghost Adventures originally.
Yeah.
He was on for like 5 seasons or 6 seasons or some shit. Actually, they're on like 13 seasons.
Oh,
right
I know.
Now.
Nick was one of the original guys.
And I still really enjoy him. I kind of miss him in a lot of ways, but I do like Billy and fucking Jay.
Yeah, dude, I dig on Ghost Adventures so sure. much. You know, Ghost Adventures, Ghost Hunters, all that stuff. I love it. It's awesome.
Well, and he's doing something very different. Did you catch the first season of
Yeah, I sure did.
Okay.
I dig on the new show.
Right.
Because I like Nick. He's a nice guy. He's a cool guy.
Right.
I mean,
he seems like he cares.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
I've noticed that, like, he wants to fix these problems, not just point them out.
Yeah. But anyways, it's just something I want to bring up because it's really cool. I'm looking forward to it because I've been watching a lot of Ghost Adventures and Ghost Hunters lately.
Sure.
And, it's cool to have another show out there that has that level of quality.
Right.
Compared to, like, some of the other shit shows.
And I can't think of her name. He does this with some other girl. If you guys aren't familiar with this, it's not the most popular ghost show out there.
Because it's so new.
But it is very high production value.
Oh, the production value is off the
charts. It's, like, really good, like, yeah. as far as that
What's
goes.
What's this now?
It's called Paranormal Lockdown.
Oh, okay.
And he uses a lot of new equipment that they didn't use on Ghost Adventures.
Yeah, he's all about, you know, let's have the highest quality cameras, let's have the highest quality recorders for audio recorders. You know, because I'm not saying they didn't use high-quality stuff for Ghost Adventures.
No.
But
that, it is kind of... I think that's the appeal of Ghost Adventures, though.
So. Well, yeah, because... Well,
because anybody can do it.
Right,
that's
right.
The whole vibe of it.
Ghost Adventures is like... It taps the found footage vein. Well,
and it's like anybody can be a Ghost Adventurer.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's what's popular about that. But Nick, really, they take it to a whole new level. And they stay... in a place for, what is it, 2-3 days?
Yeah, I think it's 3 days. I think so.
Yeah, they do 3 days, dude.
Wow.
So they spend the night.
Right.
They sleep in these
like
fucking...
Like 2 nights in a row, right?
Yeah, dude. Like, ooh. It's... I don't know if I could do it. How could
I know,
you
I wouldn't
sleep?
Have the balls
How
to
could
do
you
that?
Fucking sleep in that?
I would need to even be on pills or wasted off my ass.
I can't even sleep at my friend's house. I'm going to go into fucking in Satan's den, into his war pole of fucking hell, and fucking try to sleep in that shit? Fuck
right.
you.
Fuck that.
Shit, man.
Anyway.
Anyways, yeah. It's
So they got a new season.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
And check it's
it
coming out. When's the date? Do you know?
All right, yeah. It looks like the second season's going to debut or come out. Premiering Friday, December 16th.
Nice. Okay, so the day after Star Wars.
Fuck Star Wars.
What?
What the fuck? Dude, get the fuck out of here right now.
Are you talking about Rogue One?
Yeah.
Rogue One can suck at fucking Donkey
Dude, no, dick. I think it looks better than Dude, the
seven. You better be driving fast on the way home.
No,
I think Rogue One is actually going to be the better movie out of the two that they just released.
You know, I've already heard that. I heard that...
You should just shut your fucking cock trap right now.
Well, he's already said he's a Star Trek fan.
Nope.
He's not, you know how everybody is. It's like you're either a Star Wars fan like you, Pat, or a Star
or
Trek fan like Mike.
I
you're either a Star Wars fan or you're
because
intelligent.
I'm a huge Star Trek fan and I'm a huge Star Wars fan. So
what I was going to say is that Lucas already saw Rogue One. I read an article on it.
Okay, Lucas, he came up with what? Phantom Menace? And fucking,
I know, but what I'm saying is, like, Lucas saw it, and the director of it talked to Lucas.
Pat's
and,
all getting nay-nay.
And, oh, I will get fucking
and
irate.
Saying, Lucas, I don't quote me exactly, but Lucas was like, this is fucking badass.
Yeah,
so,
but
so
he
Lucas
could have been paid.
Yeah, he could have been paid. Well, you know, if he said it was badass, I still don't trust his judgment.
First
regardless.
Of all, and I know we're way off topic in the news here, but we're just going to do it anyway.
They brought up Star Wars. Trust me, I'm going on a tangent right now.
Well, he's such a fan. Pat's such a fan that he asked me to buy tickets ahead of time.
Oh, you're gonna bring this up. You're going to bring this shit up. Oh, I see. Go ahead. Tell your little fucking story.
How many guys did you have to blow?
You went way over the
Oh,
peaks.
Yeah. You like my excitement level there on the meter?
Yeah.
There? Yeah.
Pat's talking in the mic. No, I'm teasing him, but he's acting like such a fan of Star Wars.
Oh, I'm acting.
But in the truth, let me ask you guys, if you knew this movie was coming out ahead of time, Would you not plan for the day that it came out to go see it? Because I would. And I did.
I wouldn't, because I could care less.
Okay, Alex works from home. He could pretty much plan around that
anytime he wants. Oh, of course. I have multiple time.
But, you know.
I just
work at a concert venue, and
I'm going to give you shit about it until for a while.
I mean, I work at
because you told me for over a month, almost every day we played video games together.
And let me tell
how many days are left till the movie comes out, Alex? It's this many days and this many hours and this many seconds. And by the way, can you get me tickets to get this see this movie? But by the way, I can't come to the show when you bought them.
And I paid for my tickets. And I didn't even get my tickets.
He did. I'm just giving
He's still
shit.
Holding on to my tickets. He should give me my fucking tickets, man. You
should tickle my tickets.
Well, where's my fucking tickets?
You don't get tickets like that. We bought six at once. We got a piece of paper that says six tickets on it. And we got to take it to the fucking thing when it opens up.
Okay.
It's not like, you know, it's not magic.
I paid for my tickets. And like I was saying before, I work at a concert venue, and concerts are kind of drying up towards the end of December, and I got to get the shows while I got them.
And
I got to get money.
You couldn't have taken off?
I couldn't have taken off. I need the hours, dog.
I think Mike's a bigger Star Trek fan than you are a Star Wars fan.
It's all good. It's bullshit. All good, dude. Like I got no hate against Star Wars.
Oh, sure.
That's what it's called. It's called Star Wars, right?
Oh, yeah. My God.
What is it? Star Jerk?
Star Jake? Well, what's the one that is complete fantasy and makes no sense and it's for idiots?
Star Trek. Star Trek. Yeah. No, it's
all good. You better drive fast, motherfucker.
Oh, warp speed, dude.
Yeah, you better be going
warp. Can't see
the
Millennium Falcon. What's that thing called, the Millennium Falcon?
I think it's called Starship Failure Prize. I think, what's his name? All right, we'll just, like, get off of that.
Let's move on.
Yeah. So, anyway, yes.
I could have an entire episode on that subject. And I would be completely cool with it. Okay,
hey, so, Mike, if a new Star Trek movie was coming out, would you plan ahead?
No, I would not. You know why?
Why?
Because all the new Star Trek movies are J.J. Abrams, and he doesn't understand Star Trek.
Okay, so if there was another movie coming out that wasn't J.J. Abrams, would you plan ahead?
It depends.
Actually, I want to say the last Star Trek movie that came out had nothing to do with J.J. Abrams.
Number three, you mean?
Yeah,
Beyond. The one that Simon Pegg co-wrote?
Is that what it was?
Sounds like.
That was shittier than the first movie.
It was fucking terrible.
It was way terrible.
I agree 1,000%.
I blame Simon Pegg.
I mean, for what it was a good popcorn film, but was it a Star Trek film? No.
Yeah, but
nope.
You're
correct. 1,000% correct.
All right. And you're not willing to go halfway, Mike. All right. You know what I want to do? You guys have about the same amount of drink left in your drinks. I think the only way to settle out which is better, Star Trek or Star Wars, is by whoever slams their drink
you
faster.
You know what? I'm not going to follow your little breadcrumb trail.
I'm with them. I'm with you. I'm with you on that.
Yeah, fuck him.
You guys are both
smart enough to know I'm
so they both suck.
Oh, they're both awesome.
No, they both suck then.
Well, they're both awesome.
They're both awesome.
But let's just for the sake of the show, let's go ahead and take a shot.
Dude, I would rather drink Wild Turkey right out of the bottle than drink the rest of this.
Just do it. Let's just do it. Let's see it happen. So Pat is going to be, just because he leans a little bit more towards Star Wars, is going to be the Star Wars. Dude, and Mike,
you're going to pound the rest of that Wild Turkey? Is that what you're fucking saying?
Well, I can drink a
no,
shot.
No, Mike, no. We're drinking that. Come on, man. That's what he doesn't like it either. That's why it's beautiful. He's Star Wars.
You know,
you're
Star
Trek.
If you'll do it, but I'm not gonna do shit if you say no.
Okay, I can do it.
Do it. But do it for the sake of the show.
I got no hate for Star Wars.
Okay, right. But for the Straight sake up. Of fun.
For the sake of fun.
All right. Pat is Star Wars.
This little fucking
Mike
puppet
is Star Trek.
Right here, I swear to God.
Star Trek. You're a Star Trek fan, right?
Yeah.
So I can't. It's a pointless conversation.
But if you had to pick one, Pat, what would you pick?
Star Wars.
Okay.
Then that's cool.
Mike, if you had
that's
to pick totally cool. one, what would you pick?
Star Trek.
Okay.
Because I'm
so
not an
now
idiot.
You guys have the same You guys have literally the same amount
that's
of
all
liquid.
Good, man.
All right, let's bring him up. Let's do it.
Come
Fuck
on,
it.
Come on.
He's not going to stop.
Yeah, no. Let's see who wins, Star Trek or Star Wars.
Well, who would win in a battle?
We're going to find out right now. You guys not
You're close.
You guys being nice to each other right now.
We're going to make out later. We're going to fuck.
No, this is the showdown.
You're going to watch.
Hey, no, pull that mic towards you.
I got to drink this shit.
Okay,
I
gotta but
we
got to kind of hear you, so keep it somewhat near you.
All right, so I'm going to go to the side like this.
Okay, yeah. Do what you got to do.
All right, ready?
All right, Star Wars versus Star Trek. Who is the better show or TV or movies?
It's irrelevant conversation because they're both equally as good.
We are determining it now. This is your life. You better finish it because you are setting the example for the world right now.
All right, guten Tag.
Ah.
Oh, my God.
Prost.
Prost. You better hurry. Go, now. Who wins? Who finishes it before? Mike's looks like Star Trek is slowing down. Looks like Star Wars is chug, 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 a lug, a lug, a lug, and
a
lug.
I don't need to drink this. I'd rather drink this straight turkey.
It looks
out of the
like
bottle.
Star Wars is the better show.
But he didn't finish. There's a little bear on your.
Mike gave up. Mike gave up. So I guess, just so you know, Star Trek is okay.
I'm going to drink wild turkey out of the bottle.
No, don't do that.
Guten Krampus.
So you heard it here, folks. We've settled it. Star Wars is the better show or the better storyline than Star Trek.
I give people shit about Star Wars, but honestly, it's totally cool, man. If you're into it, you're into it.
I'm just That's glad that we awesome. Finally settled it. Like, now we know that Star Wars is better than Star Trek.
Honestly, with with Star Wars, I'm not saying one's better than the other one, because I mean it's a moot point. Yeah, because like it's all relevant to who you are as a person.
Right.
I grew up with Star Wars, therefore I really enjoy Star Wars. It takes me back to my childhood.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I grew up with the Star Trek.
One are, you know, space samurais, and the other ones are fucking space nerds. I mean, yeah. It's up to you.
I gotta say, I don't know. I think
one science
I'm really disappointed, Mike, that you represented the Star Trek fans, and you just totally rolled them under the bus. You were like,
"How so,
dude? I'm gonna lean out the window while I'm driving this bus.
Wait a minute,
and shit on every fucking Star Trek fan.
Wait a minute, weren't we doing something?" We were doing something before we started
news.
This whole. Yeah, what the fuck? What happened
well,
to
this
news?
This is more important. This is good radio. This is good shit.
You go with it, dude. You don't fucking stop the radio.
Yeah, you don't. If you feel that orgasm coming, you don't let it go.
Yeah, you don't go. Hey, let me. You got any twisty ties? I'm gonna tie off my dick right now so I can't come. And just so you guys know, just to be very clear here,
we're like his little fucking marionettes. Yeah. And shit.
Based on the drinks that they had to take, Star Trek was like, I'm too smart for this. And Star Wars was like, drink it up, baby! So just so you know, Star Wars fans may be kind of like, you know, I don't know, fraternity. And like, Star Trek fans may be too good to drink that fast because they're like the smart, nerdy kids, you know? But in the end, Star Wars beats Star Trek.
I have trouble with that.
Just let it go.
I'll let it go, okay?
For the sake of the show.
I'm going to go ahead and let it go based on your limited intellect.
Come on, man. I thought that was eloquently.
It's all good, man.
But before we finish this whole segment up, what was some of your favorite episodes?
No, stop it. Let's get it back into the news.
We'll
come back later. To this.
There you go. Attaboy. Don't
right,
give me
so where were we in the
limited
news?
Intellect nonsense.
No, because I really do like Star Trek.
Just to repeat, Star Wars beats Star Trek.
Negatory Ghost Rider.
I'm just saying, Mike.
It's all good. It's all good.
Everybody, Star Trek fans, your representative that you brought to power failed you. And his name is Mike Marsh.
Mike Marsh? That's like, what is it, Stan Marsh from like
but
South
But Star
Park?
Wars fans, you're elect.
Oh, it's okay. I mean, I have nothing against
came through.
Science fantasy compared to science fiction.
Right, yeah.
You know, I totally agree with you.
It's all right, not, stop it. No, we're not
no.
doing this.
You open the door.
I'm
you
sorry.
Open the door.
You know what? Vash, our friend Vash, brought something up very interesting to me the other day. He was saying, you know, if Jedis can use their force powers to move shit,
why don't
it's
they
like,
take
why
it
wouldn't they
hand?
Just turn off each other's lightsabers
because
when they're
fighting? Because the force is so strong in their hand that there is no power that could overcome it. Boom! In your face!
No.
It makes it's a funny joke, but it's not serious, okay? Let's not go there.
We won't go there.
Vash, I hate you, you piece of shit.
Well, we love you, Raphael.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, a third Cloverfield movie stops into a new date. Bloody Disgusting. Abrams is working on this, which is cool because I really dug on the 10 Cloverfield Lane, which was very cool.
It was pretty good.
So wait, so what about it, though? Like, so they're doing the third movie. Did they give a release date?
And did they say if it was going to be related to the movies, or was it going to be like 10 Cloverfield, where it's kind of related, but not really?
I bet you it's kind of related.
Yeah, it's going to be loosely related, because it's going to be the same, like, what's the word I'm looking for?
Universe.
Wheelhouse,
if you want to use a simple term to say wheelhouse.
October 27th, 2017. What'd you say, Will? What'd you say?
Wow, that was some dick shit right there.
Hey, you made me drink the rest of that, dude. The real Pat's coming out. Let's do it.
I'm enjoying this, like, this new side of drunken Pat.
Yeah. You never
what
see
did
me
you
get
do,
drunk.
Traps? Traps? Traps has brought a division.
He bought the Krampus out.
Yeah, that Krampus is, like, tearing us apart right now, guys, for the holiday spirit.
Dude, I'm feeling it
What
now.
Day of the month is this?
If I wasn't feeling it before, I'm feeling it now.
Yeah,
I got the Krampus.
Yeah. What were you saying earlier about the movie?
Oh, I was saying like my wife once a month gets a Krampus.
All right, no, but for what? So what? The third movie is coming out. What for? Fucking it.
They're looking at October 27th, 2017,
and it's the Cloverfield universe.
Yeah.
Huh. So this next year.
Yeah.
Do they know anything about what the story is going to be about or anything? Or is it just kind of
You know, nothing that I can really see. There's it's very vague. It's just like there's going to be a new film coming out. This is roughly when it's going to be released.
Okay.
No specifics on
it. Well, I wouldn't expect him to fucking J.J. Abrams to like...
Yeah,
divulge everything. These movies are always like so surrounded by mystery. Right. So,
and wait, that's part of the reason that
did you say J.J. Abrams is he doing the next Cloverfield?
Well, he did Cloverfield.
Well, yeah, no, he did the original, but he's come back to do this third one.
I would assume it's his
baby.
He
produced. Did he not?
He produced those movies.
Yeah. So he's not directing, but he's going to be in a.
But he's. I mean, production as a producer, you are very involved.
You know, he's still an executive producer for Star Wars, right?
Oh, of course. Yeah.
That's just a lot of shit on one guy's plate, dude. Fucking kudos to you, bro.
Yeah, but man, once you get in the zone, once you're like, okay, I got this, and this to do. And
well,
like,
he was like, he's like,
you don't want to see any of your children do badly.
Well, he's like me as far as the Star Trek, Star Wars goes. He's a big fan of both.
Right. I think he's more of a Star Wars fan.
Yeah, I think he is more of a Star Wars fan, but he still likes Star Trek.
So in that sense, he is like you.
Yeah.
Because I think he is. Because, I mean, you don't turn Star Trek into Star Wars and happen to be a Star Trek fan.
He really did turn
but
Star
you know
Trek
what the funny
into Star
thing
Wars.
Is? All right, enough. Just stop it.
No, you...
We're cutting it out. You guys can talk about it separately. Anyway, Cloverfield Lane.
Wait.
Cloverfield, I like the movie. Some people don't like it. They don't like the whole shot on, you know, whatever. Like,
pseudo-found footage.
Found footage kind of thing. I liked it a lot. I thought it was great. I saw it in the theater. I bought it on Blu-ray. I actually really liked the movie. I think it's actually a really good movie.
Anything with John Goodman, I'm going to fucking watch it.
And I think it's actually...
If I had to fuck one man this year,
it would be John Goodman.
Well, there's
I would just love him to cradle me in his big arms and like lull me to sleep.
I mean, his name is a good time. It's Goodman.
All right. So what else do we got for new?
All right. Let's do this before I run out of... data on my phone here. Okay, there's this new flick, a Meatball Machine, and it's got a new trailer out, Kotaku, for Meatball Machine.
Yeah, so I guess it's like good. A sequel or something.
Right.
All I know is that if anybody's out there, and this is my first take in watching the trailer.
Right.
If
because you
seen,
didn't even
like,
see the original or know about it.
I never knew anything about it.
You're not big on the Asian cinema, huh?
Well,
I'm right there with you, Mike. I never heard of it until
well,
I saw
yeah,
that trailer.
Like,
you never heard of Meatball Machine either?
No. When I saw that trailer, I was like, dude, I gotta go back and watch
with
the original.
You know, Bill Murray.
It's not great. It's not good.
The original's not as good as that trailer I saw, though?
There was so much... okay, when Meatball Machine came out back in 2005, I believe it was, there was a lot of, like, underground popularity. They were selling this DVD literally for $50.
Wow.
Basically calling it the most gory fucking movie that's ever been made, essentially. I'm not saying that that's what they said verbatim.
Right.
But it was big deal. And it had like, you know, the whole Iron Man thing. Tetsuo, the Iron Man style to it.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Tetsuo, was that the one where he grows that big machine metal cock at the end and fucks his girlfriend with it.
Oh, with the drill? Drill
yeah, bit. With the drill bit at the end.
Maybe.
Yeah. I don't That's the first one.
It's been a while.
I love...
I heard Trent Reznor did the score for that.
I got it right there behind you.
He did the... For Bullet Man or whatever. The second one.
The second
one. No, the third one.
Was it the third one?
The first one was Iron Man. The second one was Body oh. Hammer. And the third is like Bullet Man or some shit. Reznor did the third one. The audio for the third one.
I knew that he did something with it.
Guys, listen to that score. It's fucking amazing.
Shinya Tatsumoto, I think, is the director.
Well, if you guys are interested, we put the Kodoku Meatball Machine trailer in the information below, as well as all the articles.
What else do we got for news?
You know, I could keep talking about news, but that's probably pretty good, given the amount of time.
Well, no, I think there's a movie coming out that I wanted to kind of talk about. What was it? Amityville Horror.
Oh, The Awakening. Shit. Oh, shit, dude.
Yeah, I didn't watch the trailer, by the way.
You didn't watch the trailer?
I didn't watch it either.
I'm not really...
Tell me about it.
I'm probably
it,
the only one that watched the trailer, but it does kind of seem like a slow burn movie, but it seems like there's going to be a good payoff.
Eh.
And it has Cameron Monaghan.
Monaghan.
He played a role in Gotham as Jerome, and he also plays Ian Gallagher in Shameless. And this is an actor to look out for. I'm telling you, this guy is brilliant.
Well, I was going to say, the U.S. version of Shameless or the...
It was, yeah, the U.S. version of Shameless.
Cool. Oh, there's a... Okay, see, I didn't even know that.
And he's been acting since he was 5.
Hmm.
Shit.
Like in Broadway plays and shit.
Wait, he was in Real Housewives?
Real Housewives? Well,
you said Shameless.
It's, oh.
You're just totally just being a dick again.
Yeah. Well, why don't you go ahead and take your cock out of your mouth? So they caught
him masturbating in an alleyway?
Right.
Pat is angry drunk right now.
So, you people out there who have seen these, why don't you leave a comment and stuff? I'm not against Alex, how wrong he really is.
I'm not against it. I'm just giving you shit for the sake of giving you shit.
Yeah. He's good at that.
See how easy it is, folks?
It's fantastic.
It's fantastic. Rolls right off the tongue. It's
most, I'm sorry.
Most, you know, every time we talk, it's like watching two girls, one cup.
Yeah, that's what it's like when
that's
I see you.
It's the same stuff out of the same hole. It just keeps happening.
Man, Pat is spicy tonight. God damn. Get a little alcohol on this kid, and he's ready to fucking cut your throat.
If I wasn't here, he'd be blowing himself.
Anyway, so Amityville, The Awakening. It's coming out 2017, January 6th.
Yeah, it looks good. Check out the trailer. You should be able to find it on YouTube.
I'm going to watch it, but I really honestly have lost faith. I mean, we've gone through a lot of
What's the last Amityville horror movie to come out with?
The last movie that I actually
That's one
gave
with Ryan Reynolds,
No,
right?
the last one that I...
I liked that one.
Yeah, it was good.
The last one that I gave a fuck about was probably the Ryan Reynolds one. But there has been 3 or 4 other movies, I think, that have been done by Amityville. For Amityville.
After the fact of the one with Ryan Reynolds.
I don't know about the one after Ryan Reynolds, but there has been 3 in the series other than the remake. I mean, what was it? Dollhouse? Do you remember that in like the 90s?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
They were pretty bad, dude. Mm. Like, they were really bad. There was like one where in the back of the house there was like a lamp. That was possessed.
Ooh, watch out. It turns off.
Yeah, it's stupid. Like, that's what I'm just saying. Like,
your worst nightmare. It illuminates just, the kitchen.
By the way, just so you know, Amityville, the remake, to me, was actually a decent movie.
Yeah, Ryan Reynolds did an amazing job. It was good, like you were saying earlier about the transition of him being a nice guy and him going evil are
yeah,
two
because
different
he's somebody you're
characters.
Rooting for. He's not someone you hate.
Right.
No, but I really did dig the... remake.
I think he did a good job.
Awesome job. And
I think that it was much better than people wanted to give it credit. It fell to the wayside because of the normal, typical remake bullshit.
Well, not only that, I think they added a little bit more lore to the story than previous movies.
Maybe a little bit, but I don't know. I didn't mind it. I
really liked it.
I like it. I don't know if I'm like ready to toss my cookies in my mouth for it.
I think you are.
Anyway, that's it for the news, guys! Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and try to shoot through some stuff. New releases and upcoming releases.
Full releases.
That I feel that are within the realm of, I don't know. This is mostly from Amazon, but there are a few that I do sometimes
from the Amazon, like actually in Africa or whatever.
I don't know. There's this movie coming out that's going to be out March 28th, and this is an upcoming release. It's called ZPG, Zero Population Growth.
Hmm.
And it's marked under horror, and I've never seen it or heard of it, and I kind of want to see it now. So I'm probably going to look that up. Psychomania, two-disc special edition Blu-ray plus DVD. It's coming out February 21st.
Hmm.
The Purge Anarchy Blu-ray plus digital HD. I thought that already came out. It's like $10 on Amazon, February 17th.
Money well spent, dude.
I don't think it's that good. Speaking of the losing battles, Star Trek Enterprise, the complete series Blu-ray, is coming out for $89.99.
First of all, no one gives a fuck about Enterprise.
It had a few good episodes, but beyond that, that's it. I love Scott Bakula.
That's the
Bakula.
One with Scott Bakula, yeah.
Anyway, let's not get into that bullshit again. We also have It Came from Outer Space for $10 on Amazon, February 14th.
It Came on Your Face from Outer Space?
Right. That's what I said.
we're going to keep doing this. You know that, right?
As a reminder, Anti-Birth is coming out on Blu-ray and DVD combo.
Oh, badass.
Okay, I still haven't watched this movie. I've heard what you guys said about it.
I love it. I think it's great.
It's a fucking very cool full flick. I heard that if you buy it on Blu-ray, it does come with a bag of actual Anti-Birth.
Yeah. It may smell. We have Lair of the White Worm and Parents coming out from Vestron Collectors.
Oh, that's so old school, dude.
The Collector's Edition. That's going to be out January 31st. There's also the movie, which I watched and I didn't get a chance to talk about. It's called The Monster. Starring Zoe Kazan, and that's coming out January 24th. I actually did not mind that movie, by the way. I thought it was actually pretty decent. The creature kind of looked like Zool from Ghostbusters, but okay. They did some pretty cool stuff with it. Poltergeist 3 Collector's Edition and Poltergeist 2 The Other Side Collector's Edition on Blu-ray from Screen Factory.
Man, I tried watching the remake, the Poltergeist remake.
Horrible.
Oh, dude, I should have, like, just shoved the cactus up my ass. It was so stupid.
I got 20 minutes in before I turned it off.
Poltergeist 2 and Poltergeist 3 are coming out from Scream Factory on January 24th. Blood Rage is also coming out on the 24th. And Ouija, The Origin of Evil, which was actually not too bad. Some people have some mixed feelings about it.
I had a good time watching it.
I liked it.
It seemed like a good ride.
It's got some slow parts. It gets some fast parts. But for the most part, I think it's a pretty decent movie. I think it's at least a 7. January 17th, that's coming out. Slumber Party Massacre 2 and 3, Collector's Blu-ray from Scream Factory, is coming out for $21.99, January 17th. Crystal Lake Memoirs, Memories, Never Sleep Again double feature. So it's Friday the 13th. Double feature fucking documentary making of. Double feature Blu-ray is coming out for $25.49 January 10th. Blair Witch coming out on Blu-ray, DVD, and digital HD for $20 on January 3rd. Black Christmas, the collector's edition from Scream Factory, is going to be out for $23.20 on December 13th. So essentially by the time you hear this, it'll be out the next day. So, and also one of the things that I talked to Ann Horror on Horror Amino about was the Twilight Zone, the complete Blu-ray series. She said it is, in fact, everything.
Oh, ooh. Shit.
And she looked into it. Ann Horror literally has a collection of steel Blu-ray cases, like a wall of all just steel Blu-ray.
Damn.
Steel cases. Isn't that crazy?
That's fucking awesome.
That's pretty badass.
So, but that's coming out then. You got Creepshow 2 Special Edition Blu-ray from Arrow on $22.19 on Amazon Prime. Of course, most of these are. That's already out. Driller Killer came out with the limited edition Steelbook Blu-ray plus DVD. And one last one before we go that's already out is Slime City with Slime City Massacre, which is the double feature. It's basically the original and the sequel.
Shit.
And I guarantee you that movie is going to go up in price. That's it for new releases and upcoming releases.
Fantastic.
So now we're going to go ahead and kick it off into the flesh and potatoes.
Potatoes.
Of holiday horror. Woo!
my favorite part. I love potatoes. I'm Irish.
Hello, Patrick Sean McDonald.
Oh, you're right. See? We're going to fight you. I love potatoes and horror.
We're going to go over some movies that we feel that fall into the holiday category. Obviously, we can't name off every single movie and watch every single movie for this episode, or it'd be like a five-hour episode. We watched something that I posted at Horror-Mino that we were looking for holiday horror movies, and for whatever reason, I don't know why I never seen this, but Treevenge.
Which is great, though, because when you posted that, I was just about to post it to the group, and
really?
You had mentioned it, and I was like, damn it, we're on the same page. That's awesome, though.
Well, Treevenge came out in 2008 as a short film. It was directed by director and writer Jason Eisner, who did the movie Hobo with a Shotgun. Actually, he made Hobo with a Shotgun as a short film in 2007, so he did it pre-Treevenge.
Did he make it with a shotgun?
I don't know. Probably. He probably held it at people's faces. But no, I think because of the success of the short film that he did for Hobo with a Shotgun, people just got really ignited about it. And then he did Treevenge after that. And because of his short with Hobo's Shotgun, it came out in 2011. Anyway, Just to give you a little bit of background on the director.
And then also, I don't know if anybody's fans out there of Trailer Park Boys, but two of the stars from Trailer Park Boys are in this short.
Right.
Oh, dude.
We have, what is it?
J-Rock?
It's J-Rock, baby.
Yeah.
I think it's Jonathan Torres.
Yeah.
And Sarah, I forgot your last name because I deleted my notes. Sorry. Yeah.
That's what happens when you get drunk, Pat.
That's what happens.
You drinking a fucking guten fucking Krampus Knotten?
It is. Oh, so it's Sarah Dunsworth and Jonathan Torrance.
Okay.
Which is Sarah from Trailer Park Boys and J-Rock.
But this, to give you guys who haven't seen this trailer and who don't know what we're talking about, it's clearly a love letter to ridiculousness. but in such a good way that I can't even tell you. It's got a 7.5 on IMDb.
Really?
Yeah.
For a short film, that's nuts.
That's pretty great, right?
Yeah, pretty like
that's chestnuts.
Right. So essentially, what this film or this short film does is pretty much take trees and pretty much delimb them and the whole experience of what it's like to basically cut down Christmas trees so that you can put one up in your house.
Yeah,
and it turns it into a fucking cannibal Holocaust movie for trees.
Right. It kind of humanizes them.
They even use the song from Cannibal Holocaust.
Oh, do they?
Yeah. It's like Sausage Party.
Kind of, yeah. A little bit.
For trees.
They make the trees move, and they have little saplings and shit that are like dancing around and stuff.
I like how they speak. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, well, they sound like fucking Gizmo.
Yeah, Mogwais.
Mogwais,
yeah.
So, but it sounds very reminiscent of that. They even have at one point where it's like a monkey. It's like, like, I don't know. I can't even do the noise. But anyway, it sounds like a fucking monkey. But yeah, so the trees come to life and kill off all the people as to exact their sap-filled revenge on everybody.
It is definitely an instant holiday classic.
Dude, it's so good.
Like I'm going to watch
it. It really is. It really is fucking fantastic, oh, yeah. Dude.
I'm going to watch this every year when I set up the
Christmas tree. I'm probably going to watch it just out of the blue, even.
Right, like, right.
Like, I just...
October, I'm all up for that.
And it's so funny because, like, I do like Hobo with a Shotgun, but after seeing this, I'm, like, so excited about this. Like, I wish they would turn it into a real feature film.
Like a full-length film, yeah.
Because it would just be so ridiculously fun. Just to give off some of my favorite points, there's a point where a guy is like having sex with his girlfriend for like a really long time. And they're not really having sex, they're just dry humping.
That's
and he gets a cramp while he's like
a Krampus?
Dry humping. And he's like, oh my God, Mike. He gets a cramp and he's like, oh, cramp. And she's like, oh, baby, maybe we should just, you know, maybe open Christmas presents. And he was like, no! It's Christmas, and I want to fuck!
That was my favorite part.
And then
I want to fuck too, dude. Run on.
But the funny part is that the fucking tree branches go in her mouth, out her eye, into his eye, out his mouth, and then pull them together to kiss in this weird...
Like a love pretzel.
Yeah. Love pretzel. And then there was the other part where the baby gets fucking stomped on by a tree.
Oh, the tree topper.
Yeah, it just fucking annihilates a baby's head.
Oh, this is the way she was screaming, though. My baby! No, not my baby!
My baby!
I'll fucking kill you!
I like babies.
It was pretty great. It's probably a stomach turner for some, but I think it's pretty obvious it's not real.
Right.
Yeah.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Trees killing people is not real?
It's not.
And I really believe that trees are alive.
I believe in the trees now.
Yeah.
It's no, like Fern Gully all over again.
If you haven't seen it, guys, anyway, check it out. The information is in the information.
You owe it to yourself to watch this.
We're a little drunk. We drank that shot.
Shot?
Yeah.
Boilermaker slash car bomb.
It's like four shots. One of the most epitome of, I would say, holiday horror is probably got to be Gremlins, right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, for sure, dude.
Like, it is. It was supposed to come out. I think it was supposed to come out in, like, November or December originally. And then it came out in, like, July.
Yeah, it would have made a great Christmas movie by the time. They could have sold. Think about how much money they could have made.
Well, in 1984, the movie did actually pretty fucking well.
Did it?
Yeah, it did
pretty
good.
Do we have numbers on that?
I don't have the numbers on it.
Joe Dante, right?
Yeah, Joe Dante did an amazing job on that film. And he came up with some new shit. And they were, at one point, were originally thinking about doing apes, like gorillas and shit.
What?
Yeah, he was trying to get, like, monkeys and
those
shit.
Those dirty apes, whatever.
Damn dirty apes.
And, like, put masks on them and shit.
Ugh.
So they ended up doing animatronics in the movie. In 1984, by the way. So if you can imagine, apparently, there was an interview that Zach Galligan, who was the main star of the movie, he was talking about it, and he said that there was absolutely no CGI and that all the gremlins were animatronics. Each of them cost between $30,000 and $40,000 back then.
Shit.
What the fuck?
Right? And when everyone left the set for the day or the night or whatever it was, whenever they used the animatronics, they literally searched everybody's trunks.
No shit.
Of their car.
Wow.
Because they didn't want anybody stealing that
shit.
Right,
that's a lot of money.
Well, right. And back then, I mean, that's probably like, I don't know, maybe $80,000 each?
Yeah.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Now, is it just me? It might just be me here, but did anybody like Gremlins 2 better than they like Gremlins?
You know what? There is a special place in my heart for part two. I love it for many reasons. But I think the first one is the first one I saw, so I have some sort of nostalgic reference.
Yeah.
Or preference, I should say, to that.
Yeah,
well,
like...
I think I saw Gremlins, you know, first as well, but something about that second one, maybe it was just seeing a little bit more
I don't think
Gremlins.
You did. I don't think you did.
I may not have, but like,
because I'm pretty old. I'm older than you,
right?
Well, one of the things I wanted to bring up about Gremlins 2 was it's one of the reasons I got into filmmaking.
Yeah, I think you mentioned it once
because when I first got into filmmaking, it was all about practical effects,
right?
And
doing so much with so little.
Yeah. So I was really into, like, Fango. We were talking about Rue Morgue and whatnot.
Right.
I had a Fango magazine where they did all the they showed all the effects from Gremlins 2. Mm-hmm. And one of the effects that really hit home for me was the spider gremlin.
Oh, dude.
Because had a...
In the part two, you mean?
Yeah, every leg on the spider, they had a stick connected to for a puppet. So they would go like this to make it walk.
Mike's and making walking motions.
Yeah, I'm making the walking movement with my hands. And I actually made a paper, giant paper mache or cardboard spider.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
You know, just because I was so cool, like so into that effect.
That is cool.
And that is pretty cool.
Yeah. So, like, Gremlins 2 for me.
There was a lot of creativity in the second one, I think. But for its time... Part one really had a lot of creativity, too. You know what's funny about the first Gremlins, though, is that the theater that blows up, you know, in the first one?
Yeah.
It was actually involved in another accident with Marty McFly.
Oh.
Michael J. Fox was in Back to the Future, where it smashes into the front entrance at the end of the film. That is the same theater.
Hmm.
The actual town that they shot the houses in, it's in the same town. It was in a studio, but it was in the same town. I thought it was pretty interesting that they actually are kind of related in some sense.
Right.
this scene in the department store where the stripe gremlin attacks Billy with the chainsaw was not actually in the script originally.
I think his name was Stripe, actually.
Yeah, it is Stripe. Stripe was cool, man.
He had the mohawk, bro.
But that chainsaw fight where he's like, where Stripe's like attacking Billy with the chainsaw was never in it. And Billy, or well, I should say Zach Galligan and Joe Dante worked on that as an homage to Texas Chainsaw Massacre, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah. They wanted to have that in there as some sort of homage.
Nice.
It didn't really convey as that. I really was just like, oh, garden
maybe
tools.
If he had like a apron on or something like that, yeah.
He was wearing somebody's skin face.
That was a pretty intense scene.
Oh, yeah,
like, it looked like he was really chopping that fucking bat up. Like, it didn't look like... It looked like he was chopping that shit up.
And I love it, the part where she, like... Or, I can't remember who turned the lights on, but was to distract the gremlin from killing him.
Oh, the chick. What's her name? Phoebe Cates?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, like, remember when the chainsaw hits the ground, and it just kind of, like, he doesn't let go of the trigger, he just kind of, like, drags him
off. Oh, and it just, like, it's dragged
I really like that scene for some reason, I don't know why, but it was great.
Do you remember Phoebe Cates, who was Billy's girlfriend in the movie?
Mm-hmm.
She was in the second one as well, and she was also in Drop Dead Fred.
Yes, she was. She was the main character in Drop Dead Fred.
Shit.
But yeah, Phoebe Cates, she has that speech in the movie where she talks about Santa Claus and how her dad was found dead in the chimney.
Oh, shit. What a downer in the middle of that movie, right?
Right. Wow. That was like kind of controversial.
Yeah.
She was like, we were looking for dad for several days and we didn't know where he was until the smell started coming into the house. And then we realized that he had tried to come sneaking down the chimney with presents and
he broke his ankle.
He broke his ankle and got trapped.
Right.
And then died like horribly. And apparently that conversation Joe Dante was like stubborn about, like, because the studio wanted to remove it because
I could see why, because it is like a little bit of a downer.
It's kind of like, is this supposed to be funny or is this kind of fucked up?
Right.
But he refused to take the scene out, and he say it basically represented the whole film.
Yeah.
Which I think is kind of a ridiculous thing.
Yeah, that's a ridiculous comment, actually.
But I love it because they brought it back in the second one when she talks about Abraham Lincoln and the second Gremlins or whatever. But basically, Steven Spielberg did not like the scene, but despite his creative control, he apparently viewed the Gremlins as Dante's project, so he said, go ahead.
Okay.
And keep it in.
I remember my wife at the time, she was working on her computer doing advertisement or something. And she actually, that's one thing that pulled her away from her work and be like, well, that's kind of fucked up. It's kind of fucked up to me.
Well, yeah, and they make fun of it in the second one. She was like, yeah, I remember when there was this Abraham Lincoln guy. And he was like staring at me. He was like, hey, little girl. And then, they made fun of it in the second one. But I thought that was great. Like, I really loved that. I don't know. Did you guys have any favorite scenes in The Gremlins? Did you like anything that kind of sticks out for you?
I don't know about...
When I was a kid, it was always the Seven Dwarves when they're in the theater.
When they're in the theater? Yeah.
Oh, that's right. That's pretty classic scene. Right there.
I want to say when they're all Mogwais. And they're kind of like, they're all in the box together, and they're kind of like begging for food, and then they go down.
Right.
I mean, like, where they just eat the chicken?
Right. When they're eating the chicken.
Yeah, they shoot up the wire to the clock, and they think it's,
that's one of my favorite scenes, besides the very end scene where the gremlins go into the fountain, and they fucking open the blinds on them, and, like, all the practical effects right there were just so spot on.
Dude, that was pretty cool, man. Like, as a kid, that was pretty... far out there.
Even like the way I love it,
there's a lot of great scenes in the movie,
right? But even when when it's done, and it remember at the end where it pops out of the water after and it's still melting,
and then his body shrinks.
Oh, dude, it just looks so amazing.
Yeah, I actually, one of my favorite things, I mean, there's so many favorite parts in the movie after just watching it recently, but I really got to say that the thing that really freaked me out as a kid, and this will play into a lot of what we talk about in the Krampus movie, is the dark, scary part when they were turned into cocoons, like aliens.
Oh, yeah.
In the room, and they were like... like the music and shit and everything. That shit scared me as a kid, man. Wow. Like, I was like, what the fuck, dude? Like, this went from a fun, happy kids movie to something dark.
You know, those eggs, they looked a lot like the eggs from Alien.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, they were very much like that.
Oh, fuck, dude.
But I think, I honestly think that Gremlins is kind of the epitome of Christmas holiday movies.
Well, horror Christmas movie. Horror movie, yeah.
It's more family entertainment, but it rides that tightrope line.
Yeah, it really plays with that line well.
Yeah, it's like, it's comedy, but it's also like, and just a side note, you know the lady who runs the bank?
Oh, I hated that. Dude.
Right, because she wanted to kill the dog.
If someone told me she was going to kill my fucking dog, I'd be like, dude, I can't tell you what I'd do if I lose my dog, but I tell you, it wouldn't be nice.
And she wanted to kill Barney, his dog.
Right, that's what I'm saying. And she's all openly talking about it and shit. Like,
All of her animals at her house, by the way, are all named different types of money from different countries.
Are they?
Yeah.
Oh, is that the girl with all the cats? Was that the same girl?
Yeah, she's the one that took the thing up. She tried to get away from the gremlins. And she gets in the fucking...
right.
And then she gets in her fucking chair and then rides up and it shoots out the window.
Yeah.
It was such a great scene, but I just thought it was cool that she named all of her animals, like, money.
I didn't...
Because she's a bank.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, I don't know. I just thought that was kind of interesting. I never paid attention to that.
Like, do you remember any of the names?
No, not offhand. But okay. They are definitely... money,
like pence and fucking
just different countries, like random countries,
right?
And I think that was probably like the writer in Joe Dante's idea. Something that me and you watched, Mike.
Oh yeah,
you watched the remake and I watched the original of Black Christmas.
Yeah,
both of us are dealing with the opposites of our memory. He watched the new one because he hadn't seen it.
Yeah, I never saw
it. I watched the first one. I had seen it, but I just wanted to watch it again. The first Black Christmas came out in 1974.
Early 70s.
Yeah. And it was directed by Bob Clark, who was the director of A Christmas Story and the Porky's movies.
Wow.
Yeah.
Really?
And he did the Porky's movies before A Christmas Story, by the way.
Wow. And so, what would you score that original Black Christmas?
I actually really like it. I don't know. It's probably somewhere, probably like an 8.
I think it's really great
because it did for slashers what no other slashers at its time had really done. And I think it was an inspiration to a lot of different other slashers. I mean, obviously you have like, you know, Psycho is probably the first.
Yeah.
You didn't know who the character, the killer was. They never really reveal it. They don't really explain it. You just hear him on the phone. You see his eye. You see his legs. You don't see...
So it's kind of like that other movie we watched. What was it? Silent Night, Bloody Night?
Yes.
Okay.
But Silent Night, Bloody Night was a mess.
It was so
I hate
bad.
To say it, but that was like really bad. But you know what's funny about the Bloody Night or Silent Night, Bloody Night?
Uh-huh.
Mary Warnoff was in that.
Yeah. And she was the same girl that was in...
Terrorvision, and
so many other films.
Right.
And we've been talking about her a lot lately. It's so weird about
she
this
was
podcast.
The main young star in that movie.
Right.
And that came out in 72, 73, I think.
Mm-hmm. I think it was 73.
But if I had to compare Black Christmas to Silent Night, Bloody Night, hands down, Black Christmas wins.
Yeah.
100%. Like, I can't even... There's no comparison. The ideas... The ideas that Silent Night, Bloody Night had were cool.
They were kind of cool.
Interesting. But it was not as well put together as like Black Christmas.
I don't know why Silent Night, Bloody Night kind of reminded me of The Crying Game. Just the way
I don't know why you get that.
I don't know either, but maybe it was the structure of the story.
The Crying Game! If anybody can name the fucking movie where they do the karaoke of that song, Crying Game, I'll fucking love you forever. Just let me know. Back to Black Christmas. Like, so the story revolves around this group of kids that live in a sorority house, and they basically are trying to have their Christmas celebration. They have all their friends coming, their family's coming to pick them up, or they're leaving to go visit their family, and some dude just climbs the side of the house and just climbs on into the fucking house, the sorority house, and then starts picking off people one by one. And while he's doing it, he does this phone call that he calls on their own phone. But he's doing it, and the big twist here, sorry if you haven't seen this, he's calling from inside the house. So it's like
the call is coming from inside the house.
Yeah. It's like this big ordeal. Margit Kidder is in this movie. She was the one that did Lois Lane in Superman movies, yeah, the original.
Wow,
Yeah, Christopher Reeve's Superman movies. She's in it, and she's kind of plays like a drunk slut. Like, she's...
Noise.
She's, like, really drunk all the time. But there's a lot of different actors in it. Actually, one of the guys from Invasion of the Body Snatchers, the 80s version.
Ooh.
He's in it. Pretty good movie. I love that movie.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
I love that. That's one of the better remakes. It's not the best, but it's a better remake. But yeah, there's a lot of different actors in this. But anyways, basically, this guy gets in the house. He starts killing people off one by one. He's calling them on the phone. And for 1974, let's admit, the stuff he was saying on the phone to these girls was pretty fucked up.
A little risque.
For 74, yeah.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, yeah, cunt. Let me show you your little pussy. Your little fucking cunt pussy. I'm going to stick it in your little pink pussy in your fucking cunt. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, man. Like, I was uncomfortable. I was like, Jesus.
Oh, shit.
But I was thinking about it because I'm like, wow, this is in 1970s? Like, what the fuck? As far as, like, the original versus the new one, though, I mean, what did you think of the new one versus the old one, Mike?
I did not see the original. But
you've never seen it?
No, I have not.
I haven't either.
Oh, wow. You shouldn't have watched the remake.
Oh, dude. Well, the remake was okay. I mean, it a little hard to follow, kind of disjointed in regards to plot as was concerned. It did have some cool like kill scenes.
Right.
So it had stuff that I liked.
Well, they talk about the kid, the guy that's like actually attacking people more.
The guy with the jaundice or whatever?
Well, I don't remember that part. But...
Well, the guy with the yellow skin.
Maybe. But they talk about the guy that's attacking them.
They call him Mellow Yellow.
They call him Mellow Yellow.
Yeah, I think that's what you're talking about, the guy with the jaundice.
Right.
Who has the yellow skin and stuff. And
like, the thing that I thought was kind of cool in Black Xmas, I guess that's what it was. It's technically called Black Christmas, and it's a remake. But they delve more into the family, why he's in the house, and that he actually lived there the entire time instead of climbing in.
Because, like I said, it's hard for me to compare because I've not seen the original.
Right, but they talk about him. He's been in the house, right?
For sure.
Like, he doesn't, like, climb into the house, right?
Yeah, he's already there.
Yeah. Like, he's lived there. He's like a bastard child. You were telling me
about
it. So
he's like some dude that, like, lives in the walls and shit?
Well, no, he's like the product of what? You said that he was like... the mother had sex with her.
Yeah, the guy who had the jaundice was the mom fucking her own son.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Was that what he was?
I don't know. You watched the remake. You tell me.
I'm pretty sure that's what it was. Grant, it was the...
Yeah, it was a fucked up offspring somehow.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it was... I know there's a scene where the mom has a kid, and she's trying to fuck some dude, and she can't get off, so she decides to go fuck her kid.
And then has a baby.
Her kid has a baby. And that's one of the killers.
Right.
From what I remember.
It was edgier.
Yeah.
It was, like, more updated.
Yeah. So what would you score that, Mike?
It's not a very good film. Okay. The remake.
Right.
You know, it's okay. It's got some good gore. It's got a scene where, like, somebody gets their head sliced in half from a skate. You know.
Like an ice skate?
Yeah, an ice skate.
Okay.
And my wife was really into it because my wife is a... She used to be a competitive ice skater.
Right, so she
always wanted to do that, right?
Well, yeah, well, she's like, she's really into ice skating. Yeah, she's... But she's into ice skating and shit really hardcore. And so when she saw that, she tripped out. So I'm like, okay, cool.
You know what? That's one of the things I've always been scared about, ice skating, is falling and then having somebody slice my fingers off.
Overall, though, I mean, you did kind of like the movie. What did you say you would give it?
Maybe... A 6 or a 7.
Really?
It was okay.
I think it was better than a 6.
Okay. Well, that's fine.
I think a 7's kind of like, okay.
So,
you know.
You've seen both.
I've seen both. Yeah, I went to the theater to see the remake with my family over Christmas, like, years ago.
So, obviously, you judged the first one a little bit higher than...
Well, you know, at the time when I saw the remake, I hadn't seen the film in a long time.
Okay.
So when I was done, I think I watched the original because I just wanted to kind of like, this was years ago. But yeah, ever since, like, I've watched it and I really have a high appreciation for it. Like, I think that the original is actually pretty good. In fact, they say that the film is regarded as being one of the first slasher films.
Yeah, I heard that as well.
You know, with Texas Chainsaw obviously came out in 1974. You got A Bay of Blood, which came out in 71. Psycho in 60. And A Peeping Tom in 60 as well. Anything other than that, this movie kind of...
like laid the groundwork.
It did some different stuff that they hadn't done in film.
Yeah.
And they really didn't explain why he didn't die in the original film. He just, like, gets trapped up there. They think it's, like, her ex-boyfriend. They just write it off, and he's still upstairs with all the dead bodies.
Right. So, for you, the original's an 8.
At least.
And the remake's, like, a 7.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I'd probably say that the original is probably, like, an 8.5.
All right.
I don't want to say it's a 9. It's not something I, like... but I think for what it is and what it did at its time, I think it's an amazing movie.
Okay.
And I think it's actually pretty cool. Like, and it's one of those movies that, you know, Black Christmas, if you can get a hold of it on Blu-ray or something like that, it's worth owning. It's something I'll watch probably every Christmas.
I'll definitely go home and check that out.
I think it's actually pretty good. There's not that much gore, but the psychology behind it. And they really didn't want to push the whole gore element. Which the second one, the remake,
yeah,
did.
A lot of gore in it.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it has a scene where like somebody like rips out an eyeball. And they, a lot of eating of eyeballs, and there's like heads being split in half. It's pretty
well, John Carpenter said that it was actually kind of an inspiration to him.
Mm. The original or the sequel? The remake?
No, the original.
I don't doubt it.
Yeah, and they said that Bob Clark, actually, who was the director of the original, he considered it to be more of a psychological film than a slasher.
And to be quite honest,
and I think it is, but
I don't think you need to show a lot of gore to make a really good horror movie. I think
if you know how to wield the camera and the story, there's no real need for the gore.
Right.
But the gore is shocking.
Well, yeah.
I'm not going to go on this tangent about how gore doesn't need to be needed, because I love it.
No, yeah. I do too. Yeah. But I'm just saying, yeah, you don't need it. Like,
if you know how to do it, you can do it. You can make someone feel tense,
right,
without showing gore. Yeah, 100%. You
can convey that terror.
But there is absolutely nothing wrong with gore, in my opinion.
No.
There is one last movie that we're going to talk about real quick before we go, guys, and that is none other than Krampus, or Krampus.
Krampus.
Yeah, one of the two I watched regards to Krampus.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't want to talk about Krampus Unleashed in huge detail.
Right.
I did watch it. It's a locally produced film with some people I know that were in it and whatnot.
The one he's talking about is something different.
Yeah.
Krampus Unleashed. Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm just saying. I dig it because I have a lot of respect for local film.
Right.
And like I said, I know people involved.
So that means you don't like it.
I'm just saying, like, I got respect, bro. I got respect for people who make these kind of
films. No. But I saw the trailer and I was not not influenced to go see it.
Yeah, it's more of a straight monster flick.
Right.
Whereas the Krampus we're going to talk about,
right,
it does have monster elements, but it's not a direct kind of monster flick.
They essentially put Krampus into a fucking gorilla suit and tried to go fucking 70s or 60s style.
All I can say about Krampus Unleashed is like...
Fuck you. Fuck you for doing this to me.
Right.
No.
And the same goes for Krampus the Reckoning.
Guys, if you don't know what this is, it just came out. It just came out for rent like a couple weeks ago, I think. Maybe 2-3 weeks ago. And it takes place in Arizona.
Yeah.
And it's weird because you don't think of like Krampus...
In the desert.
In the desert. Because we don't get snow in Phoenix. And it
we
takes
do sometimes.
Place. No,
there are those rare
really.
Occasions that we've got snow here, yeah.
Yeah, but when we say snow, we're talking about like... It snows, but there's nothing on the ground.
No, we don't have
so
inches
it's not
of
snow.
Snow out here.
No,
for sure.
It melts just, before it's ground.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, it basically it takes place in Arizona. And there's two things that I've come to the conclusion with this movie, and I'm not trying to dog anybody, but there's either one, they wanted to go, hey, no one's ever done a Christmas movie in Arizona. Or, hey, I really want to do a Krampus movie. I don't really have the budget to go anywhere. So let's do a Krampus movie here. That's what I got.
Like I said, not knocking anybody in regards to production, but I'm leaning more towards the second of what you said.
But yeah, just to clarify on Krampus Unleashed, I haven't seen the movie, but just by the trailer, I judged it harshly, and maybe I'm wrong. and maybe it's just my opinion, it just didn't make sense to me. And even the trailer was cut weird. It was almost like it was cut off at the end.
Well, let's talk about the next one.
One of the movies that also has a lot of controversy surrounding it a little bit, at least where it walks the fine line of comedy versus horror, is Krampus, which came out in 2015, directed by Michael Dougherty, who, if you guys are unfamiliar, is the guy who directed Trick or Treat. Mike was kind of up in the air about that. He didn't like it at first. But,
oh, Trick or Treat, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, Trick or Treat was...
Because you didn't know it was an anthology film.
Yeah, I wasn't quite into Trick or Treat.
Right.
100%. But I did exceptionally like Krampus.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah,
Krampus was fucking phenomenal.
What about you, Pat?
I really dug it.
I'm on the same level as Mike. I thought it was an instant holiday classic. I'm probably going to watch it every year now. There's a lot of people out there who judge it harshly.
Mostly fuckers and assholes.
You know, these people are probably younger than I am and didn't grasp the idea of what it was trying to deliver.
Right. It probably doesn't resonate with the younger crowd as much.
Right.
It does and it doesn't. Like, there's like the young crowd it probably will resonate with a lot because it's like one of those movies that when you're a kid it's like, can I watch this?
It's kind of like Beetlejuice almost or Gremlins.
Or Gremlins or any of those movies that we grew up with. This is the kind of movie you're like, I'm watching this and my parents are letting me. You know what I mean?
Right.
But in the same regard, I think it still scratches that nostalgic itch.
Oh, yeah.
For a lot of older folks like us. You know what I mean? While some people in the middle may be on the fence.
Yeah.
Because even when I went to go see it, I really did have a hard time trying to figure out whether it was a comedy or a horror. I first saw it.
Okay.
I enjoyed it when I left the theater, but I'm just saying, when I was watching it, it was kind of like, I remember having the inner turmoil in my brain, like, I don't know what, should I laugh? Because I don't really know.
Well, like, a lot of the reviews are misleading, too.
Well, fucking reviews these days, dude.
Right.
They're all shit bags.
Listen to us.
Most of them are all shit bags, all high on their own fucking urine. Like, fucking fuck them. Like, serious.
They're like an IV drip of their own fucking
urine. I'm not
urine.
Saying I'm like some fucking critic that's like, you know, one to listen to, but anybody that maybe likes the films that I like or hates the films that I hate will fucking rotate towards me. I'm not trying to act like I'm holier than thou.
Yeah.
And trying to fucking spit all over everybody who may like this movie.
Right.
Like, no offense to you guys who maybe don't like this movie, but there are some reviews that I've seen that have pointed out some pretty weird things that didn't really back up.
Why don't you give me some bullet points on that? Like,
well, I'm just saying, like, some of them, and I'm just shooting over a couple of these. Yeah, I read a bunch
of
them.
Go ahead and shoot. Shoot all over.
Shoot all over my fucking face, dude.
Pat's drunk.
I am really
Patrick's drunk. Sorry. I got to say Patrick now.
That's right.
Patrick doesn't like Pat.
I do not.
And I didn't know this, which is weird.
I fucking told him.
I thought I was going halfway with you when I did this. But anyway, I really feel like there is some reviews that I've read that are very harsh on this movie because they wanted something different from it than what it was.
Right.
And they went into it with expectations. So whenever you do that with a movie, typically they fail.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, with any movie, dude. Seriously. Yeah.
But this movie walked that line between like horrific and whimsy. You know what I mean?
Right. It has a very
so good.
Has a very childlike, fable-esque sort of style about it that I thought was a good balance between creepy and when you hear the director, Michael Dougherty, talk about this, you realize that he's actually doing exactly what he set out to do.
Yeah. I don't know. There were some reviews that were kind of like on the same level that I was at, and there were some that were just maybe not. It was from a younger crowd that was kind
of not watching. All of them. I mean, some of them were older.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I just think they went into it with a weird expectation.
Right.
And that's like half the battle. It's like sometimes you really shouldn't even watch the trailer.
Right.
And you know?
It felt very reminiscent of like maybe Gremlins, of course.
Right.
Even,
absolutely.
It was some Tim Burton-esque, if you want to call
it. Yeah, I was going to say like, for me, like Bob Zemeckis.
Yeah, kind of stuff. Oh, for sure.
Like what?
Like Back to the Future.
Okay.
You're talking about like just the layout in general.
Yeah, totally.
Just kind of entertainment.
Yeah,
value.
Like, yeah, like not very serious, like it tongue-in-cheek, it's not taking itself too serious.
Right.
That's what I got from Krampus.
Yeah, I mean, there was some graphic parts in the movie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, dude. Graphic stuff for sure, but...
And one of my favorite things about it was the practical effects.
Oh, the practical effects were phenomenal.
Like, I mean, there was some humor in there. The first time I saw it, I didn't hit right. Second time I watched it, hit way better. Like, it was almost like my expectations were different this time around.
Right.
Because I literally bought this movie, like, 5 months ago. And waited 5 months to fucking talk about it so we could do it for this fucking podcast. No joke.
Yeah.
Like when we started the podcast.
Shit.
But when I saw it the second time, I had a whole new perspective on it. Wow. It was way different than I... And I actually didn't mind it when I saw it in the theater. Oh, yeah. I'll probably watch this every year. Second time I watched it, 100% I'm going to watch this every year.
Yeah.
It may not be 100% what Krampus was.
Right.
Or what Krampus could be done as, but honestly, out of all the fucking shitty ass Krampus movies, like
this
tons,
takes the cake.
This is probably more in line with it than any of those other movies.
And as far as reviews go, it's just kind of split down the middle. You're gonna find people who fucking love it or they fucking hate it.
Well, there's a certain point where you have to fucking be entertaining versus fucking factual.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, and even the fact stuff is, you're walking a fine line because it's just a mythos anyways.
Right.
You know.
You don't need, like, part of the thing that's, like, kind of interesting to me about the movie is that it's trying to be mysterious in some way.
Because
it kind of has that Evil Dead feel to it, in a way. And I know this is really off topic in a way.
Right.
But it, you just don't know what's outside. So you're in the back of your head, you're like, what the fuck is going on? Like, what's coming out of this box? Like, everything's coming to life kind of thing. Like Evil Dead was to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like Krampus did that in a very childlike, fun, and entertaining way.
Oh, for sure. I would have no problem watching this with, like, say, maybe a little bit more mature child, like maybe 10, 12, you know, whatever.
Right. But even further out.
Right.
I mean, we're old compared to that. To give you guys kind of a quick breakdown of what the story is about, and I know we've taken a long time about this. So the story goes, when his dysfunctional family clashes over the holidays, young Max is disillusioned and turns his back on Christmas. Little does he know, this lack of festive spirit has unleashed the wrath of Krampus, a demonic force of ancient evil intent on punishing non-believers and children. All hell breaks loose as beloved holiday icons take on a monstrous life of their own, laying siege to the fractured family home and forcing them to fight for each other if they hope to survive.
So, Mike, what'd you think about this?
First of all, it was much better than I was expecting. Because I never wanted to see the film because I was expecting like a really shitty just monster movie.
Yeah, and you're pretty picky about stuff sometimes.
I know.
Yeah.
And it was not. It was very, very cool. The ending was so smart.
Right.
So cool.
Yeah, I love the ending. Meta.
Well, yeah. Meta, very meta. Because I was watching it going like, okay. And Laura was like, oh, God, don't make it where this kid just wakes up and it was a dream.
Right.
And he wakes up and it's kind of a dream.
Oh, it's a nightmare.
And it's like, fucking lame. But then, like, as it goes on, it's like, oh, wait, it's more than that. You know, everybody's kind of remembering what happened. And it's really creepy. And
all then, around me are familiar faces.
Yeah. And then it goes even beyond that, where we get the actual ending, and I'm like, wow, that's fucking creepy.
Yeah?
Look, I've seen a billion fucking horror movies. I've seen a billion movies in general.
Right.
I study film. I know film. And this was a lot of fun.
Right.
I think people who don't like this film, that's fine if you don't like it, but I think it's because they don't understand it.
I think they're going in with expectations.
Yeah.
They have a certain expectation.
Very much so.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody has their own interpretation of what Krampus is or what they wanted from the movie.
Yeah,
and I think it just, if you went in with that kind of expectation, it's just, you're not going to come out enjoying a movie.
Yeah. At least for me, when I first watched it and I first saw the Universal logo come out over the globe, and it was like Frozen.
Right.
I understood the tone of the movie from that point on.
Right.
Like, I didn't need anything beyond that. I'm okay. This is a film that's not taking itself too serious.
Right.
And I can tell that just based on that logo. And the music. You know, the juxtaposition of the happy music. You're on point.
They cuss in the movie. They have, like, adult jokes. They blast fucking, like, living nightmare toys in the face with a shotgun. I mean, this isn't a kid's movie, necessarily. But it's one of those movies, like I said, it's like, oh, I can watch this, Mom and Dad? You know what I mean?
Right.
What were you going to say, Pat? Yeah.
To you, did it seem like a paradox, or did it just seem like a happy ending?
No, it's not a happy ending.
That's exactly what I thought, and my fucking wife fought with me tooth and nail about it.
They made a happy ending for it.
Oh, there's... I didn't see the alternate ending.
Well, that's because you didn't get the Blu-ray.
No, I'm not the
Blu-ray. Yeah, but I bought the Blu-ray, and I watched the alternate ending, and thank God they didn't go with it. It went from a 7 to an 8, or an 8.5, or a 7.5 to an 8.5.
Right.
You know, somewhere in that 8 to 8.5 range.
But real quick, let's nail this down real quick. Let me get your guys' opinions on this. Was it a paradox, or was it a happy ending?
It was not a happy ending.
So
there is no question about it. Like, if there's probably 20% of the people that will say it's a happy ending, it is not a happy ending.
Circle gets a square.
Yeah. I don't know. It's tough, man. It's like, as far as a happy, not really happy. No. I mean, it's definitely
it left you uneasy. Like, fuck.
Yeah, it's like, spoiler. You know,
yeah, take your 10 seconds and don't, and then cover your ears.
This family for all eternity is being forced to relive this day.
That's what I thought it was too. Like, it was like Groundhog's Day. You're forced to relive Christmas Day, that Christmas Day, over and over.
While remembering.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, spoiler undone. I love the practical effects they did with the puppetry for the creatures and stuff.
The angel freaked me out.
The angel, the jack-in-the-box, the fucking teddy bear... Like, they were all fucking freaky.
So what was your guys' favorite scenes in the movie? This one.
I liked the aunt. I thought she was funny. I thought she had kind of like an appeal to her. Oh,
the bigger chick?
She's not perfect. Like, I don't think she's like, oh my God, she's so amazing. Like, I'm not like losing my cookies over her, all right? Right. But I think she was a good element in it because she kind of grounded everything and made you go like, I love the part where she's like, well, at least someone's speaking honestly around here, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, when the
kid says that shit, he's like, "Fuck you! You're only doing this, and you're fucking da 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 da."
But Mike, what was your favorite scene?
I didn't have a specific favorite scene, but I like the fact that everyone died.
Just about, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Metaphorically speaking, depending on how you interpret the ending,
right?
But still, everybody got their fucking shit at the end.
They gleefully torn from existence.
Yeah, and my favorite stuff was, like I said, not a specific scene, but I love the shit at the end where it got really fucking weird, where we fucking saw Krampus and the kids and
he's like laughing at him.
Yeah, the dude got thrown into the fucking pit. And what I liked about
the Sarlacc pit.
Yeah, what I liked about it was it presented Krampus as almost like a force of nature.
He was very indifferent.
Yeah, well, yeah.
When it came down to it.
He was like Bizarro Santa.
Yeah. Well, you can't.
He was kind of like God. Like, he was indifferent. He was like, I'm not doing this to hurt you, and I'm not doing this to...
Not hurt you.
He's like punishing you, but he's not. Like,
right.
Yeah. Like, there's nothing... You can't reason with him. You can't bargain with him. It's just... Krampus is what he is, and that's all it is.
He even tries to throw that fucking bell or whatever, and he's like, "No, you take my family back," and you're like, "Yeah, he's standing up, he's gonna win," and he's just like, "Oh." And by the way, fucking Krampus, something that I don't know a lot of people know, because I've heard some complaints in the review land about Krampus. He uses a human face. A Santa-like face as his own face.
Kind of like an Ed Gein kind of thing?
Yes, he's wearing a fucking face mask. Awesome.
I didn't know that. That's
awesome. Like, there's a face underneath that Santa face.
Oh, that's awesome.
Which is like what Michael Dougherty was very specific about. But I don't think a lot of people got that. Like, they didn't realize that there was a goat man underneath that face.
Now, I don't know about... Okay, you guys obviously didn't have a favorite scene, but my favorite fucking scene was a gingerbread man.
Really?
Oh God!
I liked it. It's fucking good stuff.
I thought it was funny. It wasn't my favorite.
Dude, the gingerbread man's like crawling around looking for his feet and shit. Jesus Christ!
You know what I think is probably my favorite scene is like where they're up in the attic and they're fighting the angel and the jack in the box thing, and like, I mean, besides swallowing the kid, that was cool as shit, and they cut open the fucking whatever. But when the sister goes ape shit and starts wrecking all these other animals. Like, she kills the fucking angel. She kicks the fucking...
Are you talking about the aunt?
Yeah. The aunt that has the kids.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She, like, goes apeshit and starts taking out all the toys. And the animatronics for this were fucking scary.
Oh, yeah, they did a lot of good stuff.
Like, they did some old school fucking Gremlins type animatronics.
Like I said, that angel, it just creeped me out, dude.
Dude, when I saw the angel open up like that, all I could think of is the wings in Gremlins 2. When you know what I mean? Like, it's like, I don't know how to explain it. Like, I just thought it was really cool animatronics, and it's something that you don't see in movies these days.
You never see at all.
No.
Like, unless you're watching Star Wars. Nobody does practical effects at all anymore.
They do, but minimal.
I rarely see it.
Right.
At least this type of practical effect, I barely see.
It'd be interesting to see what younger kids think of this movie.
I don't care. Fuck them. It's badass.
Yeah, I think it's a good movie. I honestly will probably say 8.5, maybe more. Because I will watch it every year. So it may very possibly be a 9 with
Alex
me.
Is 8. Were you 9 now?
8.5 or 8 or 9. I just don't know yet. I've only seen it twice.
Mike?
It's not a perfect film. It's not going to change the way you think about life.
No.
It's not going to change the way you think about film. You're not going to, you know, open up the window and scream outside like, "Oh my God, Krampus, fuck my brain."
Right.
You know, but it's a good time. I'm going to say on the fun factor, 7 or 8 maybe.
Right.
You know, if you like old school effects, classic type shit, give it a whirl. You're going to like it.
Right.
I think I'm going to go with your original answer.
I think it's an 8.5.
8.5 seems about right.
It's like pushing towards a 9, but it's not exactly.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like blow my balls off and fucking kick me in the face. I want to fuck you.
But it is good enough to come back to every year.
Right. A 9 is a pretty big number for me.
Yeah.
Like, I'm a little, like, I definitely will watch it. It's in the 8 category of some degree, and it's 8.5. I think that's a pretty solid number.
Yep.
Yeah, guys, that was our holiday horror episode.
Ooh.
And I'm sure we missed a couple of movies. We did watch, like, Elves, which is, like, this really shitty 90s movie.
I watched part of it and then fell asleep.
Yeah, like, it we were going to talk about it, but we just felt like it just wasn't for us. So, guys, just as a reminder, you're going to want to go ahead and make a Santa-themed horror shot.
Santa.
All you got to do, guys, come up with a name that's involving Santa.
Santa.
Make some ingredients that you think that might win you some free shit. And if you want to throw in a tagline, hell, if you want to get as creative as fucking Traps did, the gut Krampus, make a video. I mean, like, just be creative. Really, the only reason we're doing this, guys, is because we want to reach more people and we want to have fun.
Right.
You know, we want our friends and our people that listen to us to have a good time.
And yeah, dude, it's so easy. Just go to Facebook, look for Beyond the Veil.
Beyond the Veil Horror Podcast in particular. And you'll find us 100%. But if you haven't already, go ahead and add us on all our social media. All of that's located below. If you add us, you're God in our minds. And if you are even better, come up with a fucking Santa-themed fucking horror shot. But if you see a fucking goat man walking down the road in the middle of the snow or in the middle of Arizona, for that matter, get the fuck away. Uh-huh. That shit's not normal. And if you see some toys come to life and they want to fuck you in the face or fucking eat your mom's face off, like...
Fuck them first.
Yeah, you fuck them in the face first. I don't really know what I'm saying because I'm fucking trash right now. But yeah, thank you guys for coming by.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Fantastic show.
See you next Monday, guys.
Stick your tongue in it, but I'll give you a charge.